Let's go to Washington, D.C., where Zack Ford is standing by. He's the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. We're going to talk about the caravan in a way that I don't think anybody else is talking about, and it's disturbing. Very hateful stuff coming out of the White House in this country, something I never even thought about. How unhinged is our president, Zack Ford? That trip to Paris, is that the worst behavior you've ever seen in your lifetime?
I think we're past the point where, like, you can rank Trump behaviors. They're just they're just, you know, different variations of terrible. If you're mocking France for having been invaded by the Nazis 80 years ago, like, you know, I just don't know what to tell you. But of course, you know, France was the one that helped save us in two different wars. So I don't really know that they're the ones that we should be mocking for relying on U.S. support for protection. Yeah. But, you know, I actually had to, like, search for, did people in France start speaking German? Because that doesn't sound right. You know, like.
Well, what did he tweet out besides make France great again? What did he tweet out?
Well, it was this whole kerfuffle because Emmanuel Macron made some comments when they were celebrating Armistice Day this past weekend about how nationalism is not good. It's a you know, deviant form of patriotism, and it can be dangerous. And, you know, Trump responded, you know, Trump has been saying that he's a nationalist and sort of owning that word and trying to downplay what's wrong with it. And then, you know, Trump was coming after Macron and saying, you know, you got to pay your fair share, and you got to be fair in these trade deals. But, like, if you want to, like, create your own protection force in Europe, you know, don't expect any support from the U.S. for it. And so, you know, Macron said, well, maybe we should create our own force if, you know, this is how hostile the United States is going to be about things. And that's when Trump responded again, saying, well, you know, y'all relied on, you can't rely on Germany because they invaded you 80 years ago. How would that go? You know,
it's just it was, like, it was a confusing, the logic.
Our whole staff had a, like, group conversation about how to interpret the tweet.
Yeah.
We all sort of agreed that, like, he's basically just mocking France for having been invaded during World War II. there's no really other way to parse it.
Which is why they would need an army.
And, of course, he made these comments on the third anniversary of the big terrorist attack in Paris. So, you know, really, really sensitive move there, Trump.
Yeah. What is the mood over at your office at Think Progress when it comes to White House press credentials? Has there been talk of just ignoring Trump? Is there any benefit to saying, look, he's a moron, the press conferences are just wrestling, let's move on, not cover what he says. We're going to dig in and cover what Zinke's doing and what Betsy DeVos is doing and just ignore this clown. Is there any benefit to that, to just saying, ignore the tweets, he's a madman?
Well, it's a bit of a both and. And I would say that we're definitely very conservative about whether something said during the press conferences or said in the tweets rises to the occasion. This was one that we thought rose to the occasion, because it's sort of one of the bars we use is this really shifting a norm? And, you know, a state leader mocking another state leader for, you know, how they fared in World War II is definitely breaking a norm, and definitely speaks to, you know, these other concerns we have about his America First policy and the racist undertones of it. You know, he said there were very fine people at Charlottesville, and those people were Nazis, and yet he's mocking a country for not being nationalist enough, and yet for having been invaded by Nazis. Like, you have to kind of just contextualize it and recognize that this is a significant thing that he's saying in the context of everything else that he's said. So we are choosy about it, but that was one that we definitely thought needed a little attention and context.
We don't take these clowns seriously at our own peril. Hitler, and I hate to bring up Hitler, but it's getting easier and easier now to bring up Hitler. You know, people mocked and ignored Hitler at their own peril. I live in Manhattan, and when we talk about Steve King and Trump and the bad behavior and the white nationalism in the bubble of Manhattan, I honestly think he doesn't mean this. They're not really white nationalists. They're just using these people. They're using the Christian evangelicals. All they care about is money and feathering their own nest. But they don't really mean what they say when it comes to the LGBTQ community and Mexicans and the caravan. They don't mean that. Do you, in your bubble, because we're all in bubbles, in your Washington bubble, do you honestly believe that Steve King is a white nationalist, that Donald Trump really is a white nationalist? Do you believe that? I'm sorry to say that I should believe it, but I don't.
Well, you know, over on Slate's Trump cast, they were talking about the Gillum test. And I think that that's a pretty good measure, which is, you know, as Gillum said to DeSantis in the Florida gubernatorial debate, if racists think you're racist, that's what counts.
Right.
And, you know, we, of course, had the shooting in the synagogue in Pittsburgh. There was a story just this morning as we're talking about a performance of Fiddler on the Roof in Baltimore, where at intermission, someone shouted, Heil Hitler, Heil Trump. And everyone panicked. It's, you know, the equivalent of shouting fire in a movie theater, except now right. It's so commonplace you expect there might be a shooting in a theater.
Right.
And, you know, those people are certainly that radicalized. I mean, Steve King, I definitely think, is that radicalized. I mean, he goes to Austria and chats with Nazis, and he has a Confederate flag on his desk, even though the state of Iowa was not in the Confederacy. So definitely some very clear signs there. And, you know, Trump definitely engages in all of these sorts of dog whistles, too. Look at the way that he's been talking to African-American women in the press corps over the past week. You know, we obviously had the story about CNN and Jim Acosta, but, you know, April Ryan and some of these other journalists have also been treated particularly nasty, and he reserves specific language for them as well. And even the way he talks about Maxine Waters, you see these dog whistles, you hear these dog whistles that he uses to demonize particularly women of color that he doesn't use to talk about other people. You know, other people get silly, stupid nicknames, but he says some pretty nasty things about people of color too. So you can see that distinction, whether it registers, you know, that's the great debate that's still roiling our country, is how intentional do you have to be racist? And there are a lot of us who are saying, you don't have to be intentional to be racist. You just have to be racist to be racist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you are drawing those distinctions, or you have those impulses to frame people differently when you're insulting them or criticizing them, like, that still speaks to racism, whether you're, you know, you think that you hate them or not, you clearly have these stereotypes built into your head, and a willingness to treat them differently. And that's really all that counts.
Mm-hmm. I think sometimes we anthropomorphize human excrement and put upon human excrement our own goodness, our own values. But it's human excrement, and it always was human excrement. I still am guilty of finding, or trying to, so I could sleep at night, rationalize away Donald Trump's bad behavior and think he doesn't mean what he says. He does mean what he says. He really does. Because I grew up in New York, and I remember how he treated the homeless, how he created the homeless in Manhattan. He's a bad guy. He's just bad to the bone and has no moral compass.
Well, but I also think what you're speaking to is your brain recognizing norms changing, right? You're used to a world where there aren't that kind of bad people. And if they are that kind of bad people, they're isolated, they're in very remote areas, and their impact on people's safety and well-being is very limited. And we're in a world where they are very mainstream and empowered by a mainstream individual and all of his supporters in the Republican Party. And your brain is just trying to you know, clock into your just basic human needs of safety. Is like, well, I liked it better when it felt like everything was safe, so surely it still is that safe. And the reality is it just isn't, and it's probably true that it wasn't before either.
Yeah.
But, you know, now now all of these folks feel empowered by Trump and the Republican Party. And so, yeah, it's hard to believe, but that is the reality of the world. You know, I think I've used this phrase before, but I sort of joke when people ask what it's like working in D.C. and working in political journalism. And I say, you know, every day is a struggle against just embracing pure cynicism, right? Mm-hmm. You're always looking for people to redeem humanity and show that we're not just on this descent and that, you know, whatever progress we make doesn't doom us to fall farther the next time.
Right.
And, you know, I'm still doing okay, but you definitely take a harsher reality view of the world.
Yeah, there's definitely been a spike in anti-Semitism. There's no denying that there's been a spike in anti-Semitic attacks on temples, and it does rot from the head down. It's coming from the White House.
Sure, although I'd also point out that that's not... That I think that predates Trump a little bit. I think that is even back to like Glenn Beck's chalkboard and all of the George Soros talk. You know, if we can take this like one big, scary, liberal Jewish donor and make him the symbol of the left, that is anti-Semitism. And that has sparked a lot of anti-Semitism that was also part and parcel to the Tea Party and the rise of Trumpism. So I certainly agree that he is a standard bearer for it, but I also want to, you know, note that that's not quite as new as we want to pretend that it is.
The Republican Party since 1968 has been the party of Jew haters, gay haters, black haters, women haters, now out in the open. For example, Liz Cheney, they voted for the Republican leadership in Congress, and McCarthy now is going to be the minority leader. And buried in that story is Dick Cheney's daughter, who's a congresswoman from Idaho. She's number three in the Republican leadership. This is a woman who got elected by turning her back on her sister, Mary, who's a lesbian, no longer talks to Mary. This is a woman, Liz Cheney, whose father in 2004 got reelected as vice president or prime minister by trying to convince voters to go to the voting booth to vote against gay marriage. I mean, this is a homophobic party dating back to at least the George W. Bush administration.
Dating back as far as gay rights have ever had any, you know, vision in the mainstream. I do want to quickly correct you. She's from Wyoming, not Idaho. But yeah, I think otherwise what you said is totally right that, you know, it's sometimes, you know, Dick Cheney did throw some like, you know, olive branch leaves at least to marriage equality on behalf of his daughter, but like not enough to actually care about what the rest of his party was doing to the LGBTQ community. So,
I mean, they rejected Mary, basically. They accepted her, but they had to choose between power and Mary, and they chose power. And she doesn't talk to them anymore.
They're always going to choose power.
Yeah.
Republican, that's what drives Republicans, and it's the foundation of the whole myth of the American dream that like someday you might have money and power, and so you should support these things that would benefit you if you had money and power on the premise that someday you will, while at the same time those actual policies create the very barriers that keep you from even having, you know, some of the basic comforts and financial stabilities in life. So it's really all about, you know, that primal hunger and feeding the instinct rather than, you know, acknowledging the realities of what it actually takes to live and function in the world.
Right. I want to talk about the caravan, but I have this unifying theory that explains away the world, especially since my son is reading Das Kapital 2 now and he's studying Marx. And I've always filtered things through the prism of class struggle. That's how I see things. It's not necessarily right, but that's how I see things. So I always figure it's a struggle for money and power in this world. So when I read about Trump and the Republicans, even the caravan, I go, they don't mean it. They're just trying to get more money and power. That's all Trump and his cronies care about. Is that true? Is that wrong? I think it is. I can't, again, it's anthropomorphizing human excrement, where I figure this human excrement only cares about money and power. But the truth is, there's other things at play, especially when you look at the Christian evangelicals. The leadership may care about money and power, but their disciples care about something else. And for me not to see that is a blind spot that belies some ignorance.
Well, this also speaks to how class divides aren't really separable from social divides and, you know, what white men like to call identity politics, right? Because if you feel like everything is benefiting you as a white Christian man, then you actually feel like you have power, whether or not it's represented in your own checkbook or not. And so you have a lot of people feeding into those mechanisms, whether they personally benefit from it or not, because there's still the perception that based on their identity, things are better off for them. And that's why we have to like stop catering to the quote unquote working class, when really what we're talking about is the white working class, and recognize that these issues of race and sexual orientation, gender identity, and religion are part of the class divide, and we can't address one without addressing the other.
They're pretty stubborn. Why? Yeah, I don't. I have a block on this stuff. That if I were living in Appalachia and needed Medicaid, I'd like to think I wouldn't care about African Americans and Mexicans and the LGBTQ community. I'd just be thinking about feeding my family. But people don't do that, and then they're exploited by the right wing and Christian evangelicals. Do you think the leadership, when you look at somebody like Jerry Falwell Jr. or Franklin Graham, do these people genuinely believe in what they're saying, or are they just trying to keep their coalition together through hate?
Why not both?
Talk to me about the caravan, because you have a great piece over at Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. I never even thought about the LGBTQ community being among that caravan. They're coming up from El Salvador. How does MS-13, how do the gangs treat the LGBTQ community down in Central America?
Well, first I want to clarify that MS-13 is an American gang, so I don't know that the gangs
from
in
I believe
Central
they're
America
I believe they're
are
from
themselves MS-13. There are other gangs, but MS-13 is very much the American version of that gang, from my understanding. So
they're from Wyoming, I believe, or Idaho. No, I think they started in Los Angeles, and then they, because we were shipping and throwing people out of America, they went to El Salvador and became very powerful there. It's an American gang of Central American immigrants who went back to Central America and perfected the gang.
But at any rate, there are multiple forms of gangs in El Salvador and Ecuador and some of these other countries where folks are fleeing. And, you know, first, I think what's lost in all of the demonization of the migrant caravan is that it's a really humanitarian crisis, and a lot of these people are fleeing violence and persecution in their communities, and that's why they're coming to the United States to seek asylum and to validly seek asylum, not just read a script as Trump claims that they're there to do. I mean, they are taking quite an incredible journey in hopes of something that will be better off. And it's not just because they're, you know, out to drop some anchor babies and take advantage of American hospitality. That's not what's happening.
So they are arriving. They have.
Well, there are the chunk of the caravan is still quite a ways off, but there was a contingent of LGBTQ migrants that were part of the caravan that, they've actually been suffering quite a lot of discrimination within the caravan. There are people within the caravan that have deprived them of food and shower and other you know, basic necessities, and even the other communities that have been providing aid as the caravan has passed through have similarly discriminated against them. And so when they arrived in Mexican territory, some LGBTQ advocacy organizations, I don't know if they were based entirely in Mexico or some from the United States, the identity of the group hasn't been identified, but provided buses for them to splinter off from the caravan and come directly to the border. So there's now a group of, I think it's about 80, mostly LGBTQ immigrants, including some children. Many of them are transgender, and they are already at the border now. They've all taken up in a 4-bedroom house in Tijuana to wait for the asylum process to play out. And, you know, they are fleeing some very dangerous conditions, specifically because of their identities.
Can you be classified as a refugee if you're fleeing a nation because of your sexual identity?
Absolutely. So in 1951, when the United Nations Charter established protocols for asylum, obviously we weren't talking about sexual orientation and gender identity quite yet in terms of just understanding them in the world. But since then, that same guidance protects people who are fleeing that kind of persecution. There's a recognition that, you know, there are still dozens of countries that criminalize homosexuality. And for some people, it's just, you know, a violation of their basic humanity within the view of that society to be themselves. And so it's 100% recognized that if you are being persecuted for who you are, including for being, you know, gay, bi, or transgender, you are granted asylum.
So if somebody comes to America and says, I want to seek political asylum because I live in an oppressive regime where my sexuality persecuted for it, according to the UN, you should be accepted as a political refugee. What does the Trump administration say?
Well, as we know, Trump does not believe that these, you know, asylum claims are authentic. And he also just doesn't believe that asylum should be a legal mechanism for entering the country. It's hard to say whether he believes in asylum at all. And this sort of speaks to his whole America First notion, which kind of precludes caring about people from other countries at all. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he signed this order giving himself power to turn away folks who are, you know, filing for asylum. And it's really scary. We're basically just saying, you know, we don't care about you. There's not some more sophisticated analysis. It's not that we're doing anything that actually helps protect our country or our own interests. We're just saying, we don't want you to enter our country and we don't care what we're sending you back to.
How is immigration treating the LGBTQ migrants who do arrive? You write about Roxana Hernandez.
Right. So this isn't the first time that LGBTQ folks have been part of one of these caravans. And in the caravan that came up in the spring, there was actually somebody who died in an ICE detention center. She had been deprived of food. She was held in what was called one of these ice boxes, where the temperature is just kept very low. It's not a proper condition for even someone who's being detained. And then she was denied the medical care that she needed, and she died. And so we know that transgender women in particular in any sort of detention facility are at far higher risk of abuse, of sexual assault, both by fellow detainees as well as the security staff at the facility, and physical abuse. And that was sort of the extreme version of what happened to her. But we have lots of evidence that this is happening in many other cases as well.
So we think of Central America as Roman Catholic. We always think of Archbishop Romero and liberation theology coming out of Central America and South America, and the Catholic Church having so much power. A religious sect that started in the United States is the evangelical movement. That's an American idea, the evangelicals, the Christian evangelicals. And they are growing throughout Central America, and they're bringing their values to Central America. What are their values when it comes to the LGBTQ community? And what kind of effect is that having on the LGBTQ community in Central America?
Well, a lot of your listeners will probably be more familiar with efforts to export evangelicalism to Africa, and in particular, in years past, when Uganda was considering, a kill the gays bill, which was later watered down to a life imprisonment for gays bill. There were clearly some U.S. evangelicals who were there fanning those flames and encouraging the spread of these really anti-LGBTQ views. But that isn't unique to Africa. And there's been a concerted effort by evangelicals to spread into Central America. There was one particular campaign that really targeted Belize, but there's also just been a spread in all of these other countries. And true to just everything we were talking about, it mingles with these other cultural values of machismo that exist in a lot of these Central American countries and that intersects with gang culture. And it just has the most devastating effect on the LGBTQ community, because somebody who is, the least bit effeminate, let alone actually identifying as a woman, a trans woman, they are immediately identified and targeted. There's been talk of different forms of torture they've been subjected to. Sometimes they're also forced into sex work. There's just really no opportunity for them to safely live their own lives in this environment. And, there are clashes as well between evangelicals and Catholics in this region, from my understanding. But the fact that there's a willingness to sort of embrace anti-LGBTQ perspectives among both just foments it further.
You cannot interview certain Republicans without asking them about their Christianity. You cannot talk budget, immigration, climate change without asking them about their religion. But we're too, quote unquote, polite to bring up religion in a discussion about policy. But religion is policy for these people.
Well, and the evangelical movement has really been fervent about making that kind of conversation even harder, right? They've somehow taken ownership of the concept of religious freedom and weaponized it in a way that if you question the morality of how a person is acting, they are entitled somehow to defend the legitimacy of that action because it's founded in their religious beliefs. And this is an issue that we have to figure out how to have better conversations about, because I need to be able to criticize your actions and the consequences they're having on other people's lives, regardless of whether or not they're informed by your religion. That's not a standard that we should be employing in 2018 when we know enough about the world that how we treat each other has always been improved upon whatever religions had laid out as their rules.
I want to ask you about that professor in a second. When is Thanksgiving? It's the week after this
one. Next week.
Is it next week?
I think it
is. It early? Because there's an extra Thursday this month. Anyway, okay.
Yeah, it's the fourth Thursday, so I think we're coming up on it.
All right, so crazy uncle at Thanksgiving. I've noticed that my friends who are Republican are calling me. They want to get into it with me. And my new policy is if you're a Republican, if you're a Trump supporter, if I run into you, hey, how you doing? But I'm not going to engage, because that's what they live for. They live for getting me angry. My theory is Thanksgiving, if you have the crazy uncle, don't engage, because that's all he cares about is making you angry, because he's filled with hatred. And if you can't direct your hatred towards the other side, if there's nobody on the other side to direct that hatred towards, then you direct it towards people on your side. And my plan is they self-destruct. But travel. Go ahead.
I would say I think that is a tactic that can work in some situations, but I think it depends on your family member. And I think family is this really interesting force that we sometimes don't recognize we can use. And I think sometimes when we have family members who believe things that are particularly nasty, if the rest of the family says that's not part of what we accept in this family, you can really kind of change their tune, because they might think that they can just get away with it because, hey, their family and everyone's still going to love them. And I think mm-hmm. that, as someone who belongs to the queer community, where chosen family is a really important value, and I still have a lot of literal family that I value, but I, between those two experiences and just knowing that I was adopted and that in a sense my literal family is also my chosen family in a certain kind of way, I don't want to ever rest on the idea that just because a person's family means that you have to tolerate their intolerance in any environment. Right. And I think it's a hard conversation to have, and a lot of families have norms that never really get addressed or understood beyond just experiencing them. But in situations like this where, you know, particularly if there's a, you know, a queer member of your family and somebody who's saying things that are cruel and ostracizing, it is up to the family to rise up and respond to that and protect the person who's being attacked over the person who thinks that they're just entitled to spout whatever. So I definitely think that ignoring someone who is, you know, sea lioning or just trying to get attention.
Sea lioning? What is sea lioning?
So it's based on this one comic strip where someone criticizes sea lions, and the sea lion pops up and is just like, "Oh, I see you're criticizing sea lions. Can I you know ask you some more questions on that?" And keeps badgering them and you know questioning their tone, and you know it's somebody who is trying to engage you in a debate, but only to agitate you, and not because they actually want to hear your side of things or whatnot. It's a little bit of an obscure internet term, but I encourage people to just look up the sea lion comic, and you'll immediately recognize someone who does that exact kind of badgering.
The sea lion is behaving like the badger?
Well, I badgering, huh? I'm just using it as a verb, not as another metaphorical animal.
But who's the annoying one? The sea lion?
Because I would sea lion, right?
So really?
For example, for me, it's you know somebody who starts asking me a question about trans rights on Twitter, and I respond, and they just kind of keep coming back with like questions or like, why are you getting angry? Or you know, why haven't you considered this? And it's like I haven't. I just explained to you. You know, they're baiting you. They're not actually engaging in an intellectually honest conversation with you. And yeah. So I think the kind of person that you described that might be at your family table maybe fits that description. But there might be other people who just don't know better, and the family could really, you know, take a moment to help them know better and to stand up for the person who's being attacked. Whether there's somebody in your family that matches the description of who they're targeting or not, you know, if you want to be an ally to persecuted groups,
right?
You know, stand up for them and use your family's bonds for good.
Yeah, you can't forgive certain people, and you have to let them know that their behavior and actions are unforgivable. So the atomization in our culture, my policy of not engaging, not being the sea lion or even talking to the sea lion, leads me to not understand who, I hate to say enemy, but they are, who the enemy is. And when I was traveling through Texas 2 weeks ago, I made it a point of talking to the right wing. I knew I was in another country. Texas is definitely another country. And I asked them about their guns and their Christianity. And I learned I don't know what the other side is, who they are, what they want. I have no concept of what they're striving for. And you do that, you ignore them at your own peril. Because I can't imagine somebody thinking the way some of these people actually think. It makes absolutely no sense to me. When you live in your own echo chamber, it's dangerous. Because you just keep projecting your own values onto people who don't have your values.
Yeah, I think that's right. But, you know, there are definitely people on the other side who don't understand who we are and how we see the world. And, you know, it's the same reason I sort of enjoy when you play devil's advocate, even though I have to criticize you for playing devil's advocate. Yeah. But I've definitely done interviews with super conservative Christian radio hosts. And, you know, if you can make them feel like they can have a safe conversation, you'll start getting like some just legitimate, honest, open questions like, you can kind of blow their mind a little bit if you just you have them on the line at that point. And I remember this one conversation that ended, it was supposed to be about Emory University kicking out Chick-fil-A, but it turned into like an hour long conversation about just like gays in the world. And at one point, right. I was like, you know, who was George Washington's wife? Well, how do you know that? And why is it okay that you automatically know about, you know, his spouse and you think nothing of it, but you think something greatly about marriage equality? And his like mind was like, oh, I'd never thought of it. You know, you can, there are people that are willing to engage, but you have to really set out the expectation that it's going to be that kind of healthy, honest exchange where you're actually listening and considering what the other person is saying.
Yeah. I would say 99% of the time you can talk to somebody on the other side and they'll move towards you. But the minute the conversation ends, they go back to the house of cards their life has been built on. I see that with Republicans who resist Trump, but they still kind of believe in everything he's doing.
Yeah, allegiance is a very strong force that you can change people's ideas about things, but it's much harder to change their heart and their sense of belonging to a group.
Yeah. I wish there was a way around that. I often think if we had mandatory voting in America, people would stop with the tribalism and actually pay attention to what the real problems are and how to fix them instead of being like the party of mommy and the party of daddy. And
well, Brazil has mandatory voting, and judging from how their recent election turned out, I'm not sure that that solves that problem.
Yeah, we're talking about Lula today. Okay, very quickly, the professor and the pronoun, which is a name of a sitcom I'm trying to sell.
Good luck with that one. Yeah. So this is the latest from the Alliance Defending Freedom. I think I teed this up last week. This is the professor at Shawnee State University in Ohio who had an incident with a student in his class last year where she was a trans woman and said, you know, you need to address me by female pronouns. And he refused. He had this very specific Socratic method that he used. He only called students by their title and their last name. And so he was calling this trans woman Mr. instead of Ms. and refused to change, but then just agreed to just call her by her last name without the title, but still called everyone else by the title. So now she's being treated differently. End story, she filed a complaint and the university agreed with her, hey, we have a non-discrimination policy, and disciplined him by putting a letter in his personnel file. How dastardly.
Yeah.
So he has now filed a lawsuit with support from the Alliance Defending Freedom, arguing that being forced to use pronouns that respect a student's gender identity violate his academic freedom and his freedom of speech and his freedom of religion.
Hmm. Now, this isn't a Christian college. This is just a normal...
It's a state university.
State? Oh, boy.
Shawnee State.
So that has a whole other set of complications.
Right. I mean, he's a government employee. And so if he's not agreeing to the basic contractual requirements of how his employer is expecting him to conduct himself in his job, these other arguments really don't apply.
And he's protecting the First Amendment, he claims.
So he claims, you know, I there wasn't a lot of other context about this guy out there. So I looked at his ratemyprofessor.com account and there, you know, there was a whole range of feedback. So I don't want to say it was all one sided, but there were definitely many students who said, you know, he forces his beliefs on his class and, you know, he's teaching political philosophy. So, you know, his whole argument is that like, employing his own religious beliefs is part of teaching political philosophy, which I just don't buy.
Right.
But, you know, clearly this student, I mean, when this student filed a complaint, there were two other trans students who were also interviewed who had issues with him in the past. So, you know, it's a recurring problem, but he apparently also openly shares these beliefs in the classroom and is very scrutinizing of anyone who disagrees with them. So he sounds like, I don't know, kind of a turd, and I would not enjoy him or respect him as a professor, I'm guessing. But, you know, to partner with a hate group who has made it its mission to dismantle LGBTQ protections across the country, the lawsuit also just misgenders this trans student the entire time, insisting that, you know, she is biologically male and that's the end of it, even though she has legally changed her name and made some other, you know, she's a woman.
Yeah.
So it's just nasty and evil, and it's concerning because ADF doesn't ever settle. They keep fighting until they get to the Supreme Court. And this is a Supreme Court that is not LGBTQ friendly now and could very well say, you know, you get to disrespect people as much as you want if it's according to your religious belief. And I just don't know how that doesn't then translate into disrespect other religions, disrespect other races, you know, be as bigoted as you want if your religion justifies it, just because that's what religious freedom means in society. And I think that that's a terrible direction should our country turn that way.
So the ADF is a bunch of lawyers, right?
Oh, yeah.
Right. And so it's a bureaucracy that has to be self-sustaining. They got to keep suing to justify the salaries, right?
Well, it's all marketing, right? You know, they have Baronel Stutzman, their florist, and Jack Phillips, their baker, and all of these people that they trot out and do all these, you know, really polished, sappy videos about how they're so persecuted for their religion. And they just rake in money from donors that way.
Right.
So all of these cases, you know, it's hard to say that they really make money on the cases because a lot of them they keep losing. But
no, but they do make money.
They make money through the marketing.
Well, they make money because these lawyers don't do it for free, right?
Well, in a lot of cases, they provide their services to the clients for free, but don't agree to pay their legal fees. So what happens then is the client loses their case and is ordered to pay the other side's legal fees, which is just common thing that happens in these cases. And then they put out a video saying, oh no, their business is going to fall apart because they can't afford these fees.
Right.
But they're responsible for them racking up because they keep appealing instead of settling. You know, Baronel Stutzman, the florist in Washington, was fined $2,000. And I don't think $2,000 is going to put this woman out of business. But what she's really struggling with is all the legal fees from the other side that keeps winning, and ADF doesn't want to pay that out.
Right, so but the ADF is, I would assume, a nonprofit organization, but the people who work there are getting salaries, right?
Yeah, but the money, I'm pretty sure, is coming from the fundraising and not from the cases.
Right. So the people who work over at the ADF, much like the NRA, are making a nice living and they have to keep their organization going. They're basically a solution in search of a problem. They have to create problems in order to justify their existence because that's how they make their money.
Right. To put it more frankly, they're fueling hate to profit from it.
Yeah. Interesting. And as old as time. Well, Zack Ford is the LGBTQ editor for Think Progress, thinkprogress.org. Read him every day over at Think Progress and support Think Progress. Can you stand on the line for 1 second, sir?
Sure.
Thank you.